guys, it's Danny. Welcome to another episode of our Orchid Care for Beginners series. Today I'm gonna tell you all about Vanda orchids, what culture they require, how they grow and their quirks and features, and also the various ways in which you can actually grow them in your home. In my opinion, Vandas can be some of the more intimidating orchids because they're quite large and many of the times they are offered for sale bare-rooted, but don't worry, they're actually pretty easy to grow and, despite their size, they can be quite adequate for a home. Today's episode, along with our entire Orchid Care for Beginners series, is sponsored by repotme.com, who offers you everything you could possibly need to properly take care of your orchid. From media to fertilizer, pots, and all sorts of accessories. Some of the accessories that I will use in this care series and in today's video are provided by RepotMe, so I will link you to their website down below in the description. Feel free to visit them at any time. So with that said, let's start with the cultural needs Vanda orchids have. Vanda orchids are epiphytic plants, just like most other orchids, just like the phalaenopsis, which means they don't grow in soils, but rather attached to tree trunks or branches. And you can clearly see the aerial roots growing in the air without any type of issue. They are also monopodial orchids, which means they don't have canes or pseudobulbs or other structures connected by rhizomes, such as cattleyas, dendrobiums, or oncidiums. In many ways, they're actually pretty similar to phalaenopsis, although they don't have the same cultural needs. But they both enjoy a lot of air around their root system, Vandas even more so than phalaenopsis, and for this reason, we have multiple ways of growing them, but we'll get to that. But bottom line, in many ways, they are very similar to phalaenopsis. When it comes to culture, one of their biggest traits is their love for bright light. They enjoy and tolerate much brighter light than phalaenopsis, and if you want to have a nice blooming Vanda orchid, it is recommended that you provide as bright light as possible. Now, even if they can withstand some direct sunshine, in very high temperatures, it isn't a good idea to place them in direct sunshine since they can still burn. But if you have a southern window, even a western or eastern window in the northern hemisphere, you can filter a little bit the sun using a sheer curtain or even a shade cloth. But as much as possible, do provide as much light to your Vanda orchid as it can handle without burning. Vandas are warm growing orchids. They will tolerate intermediate temperatures as well, but they will not grow as fast, and in some cases, they might not even bloom. The warmer, the better. If your home is on the warm side, maybe above 25 degrees Celsius, you'll have the equivalent in Fahrenheit on the screen, then you should be perfectly fine with Vandas. But here's a little tip. If you have very warm springs and summers, you can actually grow your Vandas outside. These are some of the most temperature-tolerant orchids out there. In fact, me in my subtropical climate keep my Vandas almost all year long outside, in temperatures typically exceeding 40 degrees Celsius, and they are perfectly fine. It doesn't mean you should keep your Vanda in the heat, warmth is great, but indeed this orchid thrives in warmer temperatures rather than cold. I would not go below 10 degrees Celsius with a Vanda orchid. Humidity-wise, again, these orchids are super tolerant, and I actually just made a video talking about very low humidity tolerant orchids. You'll have it linked in the description. Vandas were number two after cattleyas. If you are growing your Vandas in a very dry home, or you have seasons, maybe such as winter, which tend to get very dry due to the heaters, do not worry, don't stress with humidity trays. If you have some humidifiers around, they will do okay, but these orchids do not care about humidity. They are so well adapted to withstand low humidity as long as they are properly hydrated that typically growers don't actually use humidifier or humidity trays with their Vanda orchids. So in your home, I don't think you should worry about it. However, watering is a very different story. Vandas actually do enjoy a lot of water. The bigger the Vanda and the bigger the root system, the more water it will require. Now, this does not mean that you should keep your Vanda orchid soggy at all times, but it does mean that typically Vandas benefit from the soaking method of watering, which I will show you a little further in the video, because watering is really dependent on the setup you have. But as a general idea, Vanda orchids love to be watered, they drink a lot of water, and no matter the setup, watering should always be performed when the roots are dry. If you have a setup with medium, wait for the medium to completely dry before you water, and if you have your Vanda bare-rooted, you can water it when the roots are not green and wet anymore. When Vanda orchid roots are dry, they tend to be silvery, and when they're wet, they tend to be rather green. Again, very similar to Phalaenopsis. So you can apply the same type of watering routines. When you see the roots are dry, you can water. Other than that, they are typically very resilient. The stronger and vigorous it is, the faster it grows, the better it blooms. So these are the basic cultural things that you should be aware of. Now let's talk about how these orchids grow and what you can expect. So as I was saying, they are monopodials, which means they will have a central stem and they will produce leaves from this stem on each side. And you might see that I have a jumping spider here. It is perfectly fine. I actually grow my orchids outside and spiders hunt ants and other pests, so they're very helpful. So I'm gonna leave Mr. Spider alone and hopefully he's not very bothered by me filming. Okay, so this is the basic shape of a Vanda, but of course there are many varieties and subspecies of the Vanda family which have slightly different leaves. You can have thinner leaves or even thicker leaves. Some Vandas have a curved shape to the leaves, some of them not so much. Some Vandas will be big, while others will be quite tiny. The tiniest Vandas are actually the former Neophenicia falcatas, which have a slightly different care. We're gonna get to them towards the end of this video. Most Vandas you will find for sale though will be the bigger ones, because these are the ones which produce the biggest flowers. Vandas also have a crown, as you might expect, just like Phalaenopsis orchids, which I do suggest you try to keep dry. Now, if you grow your Vanda outside in the heat, water will evaporate most probably from the crown, and typically you won't have issues, but if you grow your Vanda in a home which doesn't have wind and maybe not so much ventilation, water pooling in the crown, which otherwise would not happen in a natural setting, might actually give you some crown rot issues, just like Phalaenopsis. So if you know water evaporation is impaired in your environment, try to avoid water in the crown. The roots are pretty sturdy and thick, as you can see, and they are produced from the stem or the central axis more towards the base rather than the top. As the Vanda grows, of course, the stem can start to produce roots higher and higher. So as you can see, some roots will just head towards the sky, whichever direction they feel like, since it is in the nature of a Vanda orchid to attach to a tree as best as possible. Vandas are also prone to producing keikis, and you can see my orchid has two little keikis at the base. Some Vanda species are more prone than others, but it is really common to have keikis. Typically, the older the Vanda is, the more prone it is to produce keikis. You can absolutely leave the keikis be, and in a few years, you're gonna have a bushier plant, or you can actually remove them when they have roots and pot them separately. I will share with you down below a link to a video which talks more about keikis in the case of Phalaenopsis, but you can apply the exact same rules. Keep in mind, Vanda orchids don't produce keikis from their flower spikes. They only produce basal keikis, so keiki paste will most probably not work on the flower spike of a Vanda. Flower spikes are formed from between the leaves, so practically at the leaf joint with the axis. It takes about a month to a month and a half for the flower spike to develop, but unlike Phalaenopsis orchids, Vandas don't actually produce keikis on their flower spikes or secondary spikes. So typically, when a Vanda orchid is done blooming, you can absolutely cut away the flower spike as close to the stem as possible, and rest assured that you're not missing out on potential new flowers. When it comes to reblooming, Vandas don't actually have a trick or a schedule like the Phalaenopsis, since they are worm-growing plants and Mr. Spider is jumping around. Generally speaking, Vandas don't get induced into blooming by a sudden drop in temperature in the autumn time. Depending on the species, you can have Vandas which bloom once a year, but also multiple times a year. On the market, typically you will find hybrids which can bloom multiple times, such as the Pachara hybrids. Those guys can bloom three times a year easily. If you don't have very harsh or cool winters, you can actually have them bloom even five times a year. When it comes to their flowers, Vandas can vary quite a lot. The bigger the Vanda, the bigger the flowers, typically speaking, not necessarily the case with all hybrids. The most common Vanda orchids you'll find in flower shops or garden centers are the big flowered ones, because they're very, very showy. But there are Vandas which produce a multitude of tiny little flowers which are just as whimsical. Bonus, there are Vandas which are actually fragrant. Not necessarily the case with all of the hybrids in flower shops. But if you go into the species, you will find highly fragrant Vandas. And I will just mention here the Vanda denisoniana, the Vanda tessellata, and its hybrid, the Vanda Mimi Palmer, which I have, and you have footage on the screen. This one smells very sweet. Then we have the Wrinkle Stylus Celestis Blue, which not only has beautiful bluish flowers, but also has a cute flowery scent. And here's my favorite hybrid of a Wrinkle Stylus. This is the Wrinkle Redis Bangkok Sunset, which looks like a sunset and again smells like spring flowers. So this was a little bit of an overview on Vanda orchids. As I was saying, there are other genera which are Vandaceous orchids. On the market, you will not necessarily find them, but in orchid nurseries, you will, and you will also find a lot of hybrids in between them. Generally speaking, they do take pretty much the same care. There is very slight variation, but like in everything you should do with orchids, first, test out some things. Don't ever put these orchids in direct hot sun. Always adjust them to higher and higher light, and always, always provide aeration to the root system. And since we're talking about that, let's get to the various ways in which we can grow these orchids. As you can see, I do have quite various setups here. You might have also seen Vanda orchids completely bare-rooted without any type of medium or pots, and that is a viable way of growing them as well. But there are some very big differences between all of these setups and how you should approach them and what type of environment actually they suit best. So first, let's start with the bare-rooted Vanda, which might be the most common type of display you have in your area. Now, depending on your location, you can actually find Vandas for sale just like this, completely bare-rooted, but having a hanger which holds the Vanda orchid upright. Typically, these Vandas are presented in a very tiny plastic basket, such as this, but in some parts of the world, you can even have wooden baskets. This is what we call a bare-rooted Vanda, and you can actually keep this Vanda as it is and hang it from your curtain rod or a different sturdy rod. And in the beginning, when I first started to grow Vandas, this is how I kept them, because this is the friendliest way of keeping these orchids when it comes to the root system. Vandas love air around their roots, and they're actually quite sensitive to suffocation. So keeping them bare-rooted makes sure that you are very, very safe from root rot. The downside of this way of growing them is that you have to water them pretty frequently. I personally had to water all of my Vandas at least once a day, in the summertime even twice a day. Now, to water them, simply misting the roots I found was not enough for the bigger Vandas. So what I used to do is prepare buckets of water in which I dunked my Vandas with their root system, not completely, and I left them there for 10-15 minutes, sometimes even 30 minutes, to completely saturate the roots and let the Vandas absorb the water. They can actually absorb a lot of water. The bigger the Vanda, the more water it can hold on to. This technique gives you freedom of actually placing your Vanda wherever and moving it pretty much wherever you like. It is also very interesting to see the root system exposed, but it can take a lot of maintenance because you need to be on top of watering. It is, however, one of the most popular ways of keeping your Vanda. Another very popular display, in certain parts of the world at least, is buying or keeping your Vanda in a glass vase. Some growers call this vase culture. And what the vase does is actually offer a support on a horizontal, provided you don't have anywhere to hang your orchid, and also provide a means to water it. In essence, this is still a bare-rooted Vanda because we don't have any type of medium. Also, the vase provides a lot of ventilation. It really doesn't impair airflow around the roots, but it can give you the possibility of actually displaying your Vanda on a table. Watering a Vanda in a vase can be done once a day, depending on your environment or season, maybe even less than that. And the way we are providing water for these types of setups is simply by filling the vase with water, again letting the roots soak for 10, 15 minutes, 30 minutes, and then dumping out all of the water, letting the orchid sit bare-rooted once again in the vase. Vandas can also be grown in open baskets, and the most typical one is the wooden Vanda basket. As you can see, you can grow other epiphytic orchids in baskets as well. You can keep Vandas bare-rooted in these baskets and their roots will simply hang on to the wood, or you can also add a little bit of medium if your environment tends to be rather hot, rather dry, and water evaporates really, really fast. In a basket, the roots will still benefit from a lot of air, but this setup can also provide a means for you to contain the roots, even offer them a little bit more humidity while still hanging the orchid wherever you'd like. And of course, you can also keep your Vanda orchids in pots. And this is my preferred way of keeping them and growing them at the moment, since I do have very, very hot temperatures, which Vandas really like, but water evaporates very, very fast. But as you can see, I did choose pots which offer a great deal of ventilation. I have unglazed terracotta pots, which are porous and let water seep out. And I also have glazed terracotta pots, which have pre-made holes. And these are my favorites at the moment. They are from RepotMe, and they can make a nice statement in the home. Now, pots can also be used as baskets. You don't actually have to add medium inside them. Many growers use pots just to contain the roots and offer the Vanda orchid a place to live in, but they don't add medium because it would retain a little bit too much water. So you are free to actually customize whatever setup you see in order to better suit your environment. And the way that you can choose setups is actually based on how your environment is. Typically, the more airy setups, such as the open baskets or bare-rooted setups, are very suited for those environments which are not very hot, maybe they're a little bit more humid, maybe they don't experience a lot of variation in temperature throughout the year, and are not exposed to high temperatures. While setups which retain more water, such as the baskets with medium inside them and the pots, these are suited for higher temperatures which promote water evaporation, maybe dry environments. There are many details that form your environment, from temperature to humidity, even to your availability to water. Whatever setup you choose, just keep in mind Vandas love air around their root system. You should never keep them soggy, and you should always let the roots dry out completely before you rewater them. And if you are not sure if you should water and you're in doubt, wait another day. Vandas are very tolerant, and rather than you suffocating the roots, it's better to leave the setup completely dry out. Now, I was mentioning the Neophenicia falcata at the beginning of the video. This orchid has recently been reclassified as a Vanda, and depending on where you purchase it from, you might find it under a Vanda name. However, this orchid is quite different. It doesn't take the same care and culture as a Vanda. First of all, it really doesn't need as much light as a Vanda and can be a little bit more sensitive to it. It also benefits from a noticeable cool down during winter time in order to bloom in the summertime. It is much more tolerant to moisture, and in my opinion, a Vanda is actually slightly easier to take care of than a Neophenicia. So keep that in mind if you see the Vanda falcata for sale. This tutorial doesn't really apply to it. However, in my experience, it can apply to its hybrids. Since these orchids are compatible, the Vanda and the Neophenicia, you will find Vanda and Neophenicia hybrids. And I did discover that with the majority of them, which are considerably larger, that they took a lot of the tolerance of the Vanda when it comes to water, temperature, and even light. So this tutorial applies to the majority of the Neophenicia hybrids, which look rather like a Vanda than a Neophenicia. So that is about it on Vanda orchids for today. I hope you guys enjoyed this video and you learned something new. And if you were a little bit intimidated by them, but you really, really wanted to try out with one, well, I hope you have a little bit more courage now. In the end, with new orchids, no matter how much experience you have, it's a little bit of trial and error. You need to start from somewhere, so take this tutorial as the baseline and don't be afraid to customize it based on what your orchid is telling you. Because trust me, it will tell you a lot of things. So that said, thank you so much for watching. Thank you, RepotMe, for sponsoring yet another care tutorial. Subscribe to my channel for more orchid videos, tutorials, experiments, updates, and other fun orchid subjects. If you wish to support the channel, do consider becoming a member or visit the merch store linked down below in the description. You can also follow me on Instagram and Facebook. It's always nice to stay in touch there as well. And with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!